the subject of lecture four is this social interaction model, which we introduced and went through last week, which is a very stripped down model of social interaction. And the reason for stripping it down so much is because, in fact, what's going on in these social interactions is potentially so complex that if you try to work it out in any kind of general setting, the analytics become extremely complex and extremely difficult to follow. So the advantage of this setup, which depends a lot on symmetry and gets a lot of mileage out of the symmetry of the situation, is that you are able to understand what's really a very complex interaction and still have it manageable analytically. You can even use this graph to work through these problems. The basic setting of the social interaction model is a society or an interaction that involves a number, has to be more than one, but doesn't have to be a lot of them. You better just go across this. It doesn't have to be a lot of people, but it can be a lot of people. So the number of interactors can be either a small number or a large number, but there has to be at least two. And each of these interacting individuals controls the level of some significant social action. So this might be in economics how much they purchase of a particular good, or what the probability they'll vote for somebody is, or what's the we'll see some probability examples later today that are quite interesting because that leads into the theory of social conventions and norms. So we distinguish the average level of the action of everyone else from the level of the action for a particular agent, who I always call the typical individual. The typical individual is just picked out at random, and it really doesn't matter which one we pick out because they're all the same. It's just an analytical convenience to focus on one particular agent. The way you read this graph then is that along the horizontal axis is the action of society, of the rest of the system, and along the vertical axis is the action of the typical individual. The blue line is the 45-degree line, where they're equal, and it's evident from considerations of symmetry that an equilibrium has to lie on that line, because since they're all identical, they all have to wind up doing the same thing, pretty much. Then the red line is the best response of the typical agent. So the logic that we're taking here is we say, suppose the typical agent knew that everybody else was going to do a certain level of the action, Z. What would the best response of the agent be? And we're typically limiting ourselves in this initial discussion to best responses that are linear. And the slope of this linear part of the best response is the parameter beta, but are limited by a high and a low level of the action. So there's some, and in some cases that's a very natural restriction. For example, if the action is the probability that you're going to do something, or the frequency with which you're going to do something, then it's very natural that you can't do it with a frequency less than zero, that's the lowest you can go, and you can't do it with a frequency higher than one, that's the highest you can go. So there's a natural high and low. This example that's illustrated in the interactive diagram now is the most complicated one, actually. It's the one where beta is bigger than one. So there's a very strong strategic complement the more other people do the thing, the more the typical agent wants to do it. And in fact, the typical agent responds to a little increase in what everybody else does by doing it even more than them. So there's like a multiplier effect at the level of the individual agent. And as a result, the best response crosses the 45 degree line in three different intersections, all of which are equilibria of this model. But the middle one is unstable, so we would not expect to ever see that in real life. The reason we think it's unstable is that if you started there, a small perturbation either direction of the average would get amplified rather than diminished, and therefore you move away from this interior equilibrium point towards one of the external equilibrium. There are two other cases here. One is the case where, let's move alpha up to a positive number. Beta to a alpha 2 right here. Okay, this is a case where beta is positive, so there's strategic complementarity, but beta is less than 1. So there's only one intersection, the interior intersection, and the interior intersection is the stable equilibrium. This, you'll notice, and we'll come back to this later, looks very much like Haynes's cross, the intersection between aggregate demand and income, and the income line, which in fact I think is an example of. Or why don't you just walk by? The other possible case is one where alpha is positive and beta is actually negative. So that looks like this. And that's a case of strategic substitutability. The more everybody else does whatever it is, the less the typical agent wants to do it. And so you have a kind of negative externality, multiplicative externality in this case. Part of the drama of this is that except in the very special case where beta is equal to 0, so there's no multiplicative externality, and the gamma, which is the additive, the wave of an additive externality, is also 0, except in those cases, the equilibria of the social interaction models are not socially coordinated. By socially coordinated, we mean, suppose you let one agent pick both what she does and what everybody else does in order to, but she's constrained to make them the same. She has to be on the 45 degree line. What level of the action would she pick? And that is always shown in this interactive plot as a green dot. And you can actually see how it works if you look at these difference curves. The difference curve here, you'll notice, is vertical at the equilibrium because the typical individual is maximizing against the action of the others. And you can also figure out exactly what it means to have the green dot at this point. When you have strategic substitutability of this kind, in the equilibrium, they wind up doing too much of the action. The equilibrium is too high. It's like a negative externality. When beta is bigger than 0 but less than 1, then there is an internal equilibrium like this. It turns out that you do too little of the action. It's because there's like a positive externality. And when beta is bigger than 1, it turns out that the socially coordinated outcome is always at one of the limits, is always at one of the constraints. And which one it's at just depends on the balance of the externalities. The beta externality, which is multiplicative, and the gamma externality, which is additive. Let me stop here and as a review of the basics of this model and see if anybody has a question about this. Yes, Marcia.
Can we have an example of a strategic substitutability?
Strategic substitutability? Well, we did that actually last week. The tragedy of the commons has strategic substitutability, because the more cows everybody else puts on the common, the lower is the incentive for any individual to put more cows on the common, because the productivity on the common goes down. So that's an example of the strategic substitutability. Strategic complementarity is, for example, a bubble in asset markets. If everybody else is buying the stock, you want to buy the stock. And so you can have a model of this. Okay.
Yeah.
I had a quick question about the indifference curves.
Sure.
I just wanted to know, like, what's the derivation on that? Like, how do we know that they are where they are, so to speak?
Okay, in this particular example is drawn with a quadratic payoff function for the typical individual. And the two sets of indifference curves, it's like an edgeless box. These indifference curves over here are for the typical individual, and the other ones are for everybody else.
Okay.
And therefore, you'll find that the green dot is always either at a tangency, like in the edge of the box, or if it goes up to the extreme, it's a corner, like a corner solution of the edge of the box.
Okay.
Okay, so let's continue then. We went through the facts on this slide, which are discussed the strategic substitutes case, the strategic complements case, and the fact that in general, one interesting thing about this type of model is that equilibria are not socially coordinated. And why that becomes interesting in political economy is because I'm going to try to convince you that many issues in political economy, both classical political economy, Marxian political economy, and Keynesian political economy, are basically social coordination issues. And therefore, if we set them up in this way, we get a simple model that can solve these kinds of problems, at least in the special case where all of the agents are taken to be identical. We can actually relax that to some degree, as we'll see in a variety of ways. Okay, so we did the tragedy of the commons, so I'm going to skip over that because we did that last week, and you can review if you have questions. Let's discuss a little bit more the case of the strong strategic complementarity. First of all, with a strong strategic complementarity, you have to assume that there's the upper and lower limits. If you don't assume upper and lower limits, then in many cases there will be no stable solution, there will be no stable equilibrium at all. So the only way you get stable equilibrium is through imposing the upper and lower limits. That may seem a little more troubling in the abstract, but in all the cases that I've ever worked with, there is a very natural upper and lower limit, and you can, practically speaking, understand it from the situation that you're trying to model, and I'll try to explain that when we get to some more examples of these kinds of models. Um, what's interesting about strong strategic complementarity is that we can predict in a model, in a situation with strong strategic complementarity, that the system is going to wind up at one of the extremes or the other. This is often called the assurance, an assurance game in game theory. So you can predict it's going to wind up at one extreme or the other. And in fact, you can say a little bit more than that, because in that case, this interior equilibrium is in fact the boundary between basins of attraction for the two extreme equilibria, in the sense that if the model starts with the social action, let's say below this level, then it'll converge down to the lower level. And if it starts with the social action above that level, it'll converge up to the upper level. This can sometimes be very helpful, especially when we, as I'll try to do later today, combine this model with the entropy-constrained behavior model. This can give you quite a bit of information about what's going on, because if you can calculate or estimate this interior equilibrium, it tells you something about where, whether you're more likely to land at the upper or the lower case. But with strong strategic complementarity, while we can make a very firm prediction that the system is going to go to one extreme or another, the technical terminology is monomorphic. These things are called monomorphic. It means one case, because at the two extremes, everyone is doing the same thing, especially if you think about this in terms of probability. Or frequencies, the frequency is one or zero, whatever it is. We'll look at those examples in a moment. But we don't actually know which of the stable equilibria we'll see. And in that sense, this is a very good example, simple but very powerful example, of what's called path dependence. We're almost certain that we're going to observe the system either at the upper or at the lower equilibrium. But which one is going to depend on something that we may not be able to see, which was conditions in the past when this process started, and whether the process started on one side or the other side of the interior equilibrium, and therefore moved in one direction or the other. So that's an example of path dependency of equilibrium in this setting. Now, in the case where you have strong strategic complementarity, that's the case where beta is bigger than one. We saw that the social coordination outcome is interior only if beta is less than 1/2. So when you have strong strategic complementarity, you know that the social coordination action has to be at one of the extremes. And you can see why that's true if you look back for a moment at the social coordination solution. The social coordination solution, remember, is alpha plus gamma over 1 minus 2 beta. That's going to be interior if beta is less than 1/2. Why is it? It's because in that case, the social coordination, this function, the social coordination function, is actually a concave function. It's a parabola, because you're minus beta minus 1/2, if beta is less than 1/2, times x squared over 2, the coefficient on x squared is negative. So you have the internal, an interior equilibrium. But if beta is bigger than 1/2, then the social coordination payoff function becomes convex. The coefficient on the x squared term becomes positive. And you know, in that case, it wants to go to either very big or very infinitely big or infinitely small x. And the only thing that's going to stop it is the limits. So the maximum is going to turn out to be at one or the other limit point. And the last point about strong strategic complementarity is that you have two stable equilibrium outcomes at the two limits, but they are in generally not equivalent in terms of payoff. One of them is as the one that's socially coordinated, typically has a higher payoff than the other one. And that means if the system somehow gets to the bad equilibrium or the low equilibrium, the poverty trap, or whatever you, however you want to think of it, then that's worse, has a worse payoff, not just for the typical agent, but for all of the agents in the system, all the individuals in the system. And this links up with major issues in economic policy, which often have to do with trying to move a system from a bad equilibrium to the socially coordinated equilibrium. If you think of, for example, traffic and commuting in New York, the bad equilibrium is the one where, that's not a good example because that's actually a socially, a strategic substatibility case. Actually, more general, that's another example, right? But when you're commuting in, the more other people are driving, the less incentive you have to drive. The social interaction model with strong strategic complementarity is often called an assurance game. It's also often regarded as a network externality. And I'll give you an example of the network, both ideas, in just a moment. The reason it's called network externality is that one of the leading examples of this is something like a telephone network, where there's, say, two competing telephone networks, and you can hook up to one or the other. Clearly, the more people are on one network, the more incentive you have to join that same network, because the reason you have the telephone is presumably to talk to as many people as you can, or at least have the potential to talk to as many people as you can. And network externalities are at the heart of many modern technological monopolies where winner-take-all dynamics prevail. There's only going to be one big social networking site, or probably only one, and then maybe a few much smaller competing ones, computer operating systems and the like. Let me just move along and give some examples, and we'll have some discussion of this. A particularly useful application of the social interaction model is to situations where the typical agent adopts a mixed strategy. The typical agent now doesn't choose, X is now not a level of something like how much did you buy or how much did you spend. It's a probability that you did one particular thing. Did you buy that computer operating system, a Mac operating system, or a Windows operating system? That's a quantal decision. You can only do a 0-1 decision. And then the issue now is the frequency with which people do each one. And that's very helpful in using this model with data, because data often comes in the form of observations of what proportion of a population is doing a particular thing, has chosen one standard or one operating system, or is conforming to one social norm or another social norm, or that kind of question. In this, in the probability cases, the action limits are very naturally, go across them. The action limits are very naturally E equals zero, the frequency is equal to zero, or the frequency is equal to one, because you can't do the thing more often than all the time, which is frequency equals one, and you can't do the thing a negative proportional to time. The worst you can do is zero, just never do it. So you have a very natural, that Z shape, best response becomes a very natural feature of these kind of model response models. When we think about quantal response models, the interior equilibrium of the social interaction model is called a polymorphic state. Because what it means now, if we interpret it that way, is that this Z is the proportion of the population, or the frequency with which the typical individual does one action or the other. But then, if there's a reasonably large number of individuals, the law of large numbers tells you that it's the proportion of individuals that you would expect to see doing one or the other thing. And if the interior equilibrium were stable, then that would be a polymorphic equilibrium in the sense that we would expect to see some of the agents doing one and some of the agents doing the other thing. Polymorphic because there are many outcomes possible. But in the strong strategic complementarity case, you're going to get a monomorphic equilibrium, which means either nobody does it, the frequency of any individual doing it is zero, so by the law of large numbers, you never see or hardly ever see anybody do it. Or you're at one, the frequency of the typical individual doing it is one, in which case you're almost certain to find people doing whatever the action is, the quantum action is. That's called a monomorphic equilibrium, as I mentioned a moment ago, because in those equilibrium you only find one type of behavior. Everybody joins Facebook. Nobody joins MySpace. Everybody has a Windows computer. Nobody has a Mac computer. Or that type of outcome. So let's look at an example. I'll skip this. Oh no, let's skip this slide that you can look at it on your own. And look at the social coordination. Well, let's go through this because we'll use this frequently, so I want to make sure that all of the examples are, all of these examples are there. So we're now going to assume that the typical agent has to choose either to take an action, which means x equals one, or not take the action, in which case x equals zero. Suppose the payoff depends on whether or not the other participants take the action. So we're going to either have z equals zero or one, two, if they all do the same thing. And suppose that the payoff is the same type of payoff, alpha plus beta z times x. So in this case, beta measures whether there's strategic substitutability or strategic complementarity, and the product tells you that there's this interaction between the actions of the two. you can see that the payoff matrix for the interactive game looks like this. We'll measure X as the role player in this payoff table, and Z, the others, as the column player. So when Z is zero and X is zero, then the payoff is zero, right? For both the typical agent and for the rest of the society. Suppose the rest of the society does the action, but the typical player does not, except zero. Then you can see the typical player's payoff is zero because x, you said x equals zero, whatever you multiply by is zero. But the rest of society gets a payoff of alpha. just their loan payoff without any externality from the typical individual. And then this is symmetrical for when the typical individual does the action and the rest of society doesn't. If they both do the action, then they both get a payoff alpha plus b. As you can see, when you put z equal to 1 and x equal to 1, then you get alpha plus beta for both of them. We can use this basic idea to calculate the payoff for different frequencies. So now p is the frequency with which the typical individual does the action, and p bar is the frequency with which everybody else does it, which can also, in most cases, be thought of as the proportion of the society that's doing the other action. And we make that equal to alpha plus beta p bar times p. That's the payoff to the typical individual. And we have the limits that the frequency, the low frequency is zero, the high frequency has to be one. You can't do it more than 100% of the time or less than 0% of the time. And the best response is to set the frequency with which you do it to be equal to one if alpha plus beta p bar is greater than zero, and to set it equal to zero if alpha plus beta p bar is less than zero. What kind of function is this? So think about, so you're going along the horizontal axis, p bar is being measured along the horizontal axis. And so it's, yeah, Oriel, what?
At the heavy side?
It's a heavy side step function, right? In other words, you switch completely from not doing the action to doing the action. So in that sense, it's just like the loose von Neumann-Morgenstern experiment, where you choose the probability, you choose the lottery, or one lottery or the other, depending on which one has the higher payoff. Okay. If zero lies between, minus alpha over beta lies between zero and one, there's going to be interior equilibrium at the frequency minus alpha over beta. When beta is less than zero, you have strategic substitutability, and the Heaviside function is downward, comes downward, right? So when everybody else is not doing it, you want to do it, and when everybody else is doing it, you don't want to do it. Okay, so you have that arrangement. And if minus alpha over beta is negative, there's going to be unique, stable equilibrium at with frequency zero. Nobody will ever do it. If minus alpha over beta is bigger than one, there's a unique, stable equilibrium at frequency one. Everybody does it. Everybody does it. The social coordination story is exactly the same. We can figure out the expected payoff that you could get if you could decide the frequency with which everybody else did the action. So now you're the commuter, but you not only decide the frequency with which you drive your car into work, but everybody else will do the same thing. Or you're a user of a park, and you can decide not only the frequency with which you pick up your litter, but the frequency with which other people pick up their litter. Right? You're in a sort of dictatorial position in imagination, which is very difficult to get into. And therefore, you can socially coordinate. Well, what happens? Well, then the payoff function becomes alpha plus beta p times p bar, but p bar is going to be the same as p, right? Because we're now in the social coordination mode. So that's alpha plus gamma times p plus beta p squared. If beta is negative, what kind of function is this? It's always a quadratic function. It's a concave or convex. it's a concave function, right? Because beta negative means it's a parabola. And you've got strategic substitutability. When zero, alpha plus gamma lies between zero and minus two beta, the social coordination outcome is at the interior critical point, which is minus alpha plus gamma over two beta. If alpha plus gamma is less than zero, then you go to zero. And if alpha plus gamma is bigger than minus two beta, you go to frequency one. Is your best outcome. If beta is bigger than zero, you have strategic complementarity, right? The more other people do it, the better off the typical agent is doing it, doing whatever the action is. And the social coordination outcome is at the extreme point with the higher payoff. So what you want to do is either everybody does it or nobody does it, depending on the payoffs. When you have when no one does it, that is P is equal to P bar is equal to zero, the typical individual gets a payoff of zero. You can see that here, right? Set P equal to zero, you get nothing. When you get P equals P bar equals one, the typical individual's payoff is alpha plus gamma plus beta. So you get both the externality, both the additive externality and the multiplicative externality. Now one wrinkle here, which is not brought out a lot in welfare economics discussions, is that it's quite possible for there to be a positive additive externality, that is gamma can be positive, even if beta is negative, or vice versa. That is, you can have strategic complementarity but a negative additive externality. So it's not an open and shut case whether you want to go towards frequency equals one equilibrium or you want to go to frequency equals zero equilibrium. You want to see what the balance is between the additive and the multiplicative externality. Let me do one example and then I'll stop and see if we have questions about any of this because I've now gone through quite a bit of material. Here's a classic game, which is in Bowles' book, Microeconomics, called the hawk-dove game. And we're now thinking that the individuals in the society can choose to be a hawk. This is really supposed to be a little Hobbesian game. It's about the war of all against all, or social cooperation, and that kind of thing. So you're either a hawk with probability P, or a dove with probability 1 minus P, or let's say frequency 1 minus P. And the payoff matrix looks something like this. If you're the typical individual, and you choose to be a hawk, and you meet another individual who's acting like a hawk, the idea is that you fight and you do damage to each other, so the net payoff is negative for hawks, intersections with hawks. If, on the other hand, what doves do, on the other hand, is when they meet a hawk, they give up the prize that might be fought over, which in this case is supposed to be 100, the payoff of 100. So a hawk meeting a dove gets 100, and the dove gets nothing. The dove flutters away to safety, and the hawk gets the good nesting spot or the whatever the prize is. If you're a dove and you need a hawk, then the payoff is just the inverse, as you would expect. But what happens when two doves meet is interesting. The two doves divide up the prize, so they each get 50. Prize of 50. And the drama in this game is who has the sort of evolutionary advantage, the hawks or the doves. Well, we can think about this through the social interaction model. This is a good example of it. The P bar is the proportion of the population who are being hawks or the frequency with which anybody in the population wakes up one morning and is a hawk, you know, wake up feeling aggressive and ready to take on the world. And therefore, the frequency that the other participation in an interaction will be a hawk. So what are the expected payoffs? Well, the payoff, expected payoff to being a hawk, when the fraction of the population or the frequency of needing a hawk is p bar, is minus 20 p bar plus 100 times 1 minus p bar. If you look back here, you get that just from this row, right? Minus 20. So in a fraction p bar of the interactions, you get minus 20 because you fight with the other hawk and you do damage. But in the rest of them, you need a dove and you get the whole thing. So that's the 100 times 1 minus p bar, which gives 100 minus 120 p bar. The payoff to a dove is 0, meaning a hawk, because the dove, meaning a hawk, runs away and doesn't get anything. But 50, meaning a dove. So it's 50 minus 50 p bar. So we can work out the actual payoff, joint payoffs, and find the best response. And the best response of the risk-neutral expected payoff maximizing agent is going to turn out to be you're a hawk with frequency 1 if everybody else is a hawk with frequency less than 5 cells. But you're a dove with frequency 1, that is, your hawk is 0 if the fraction of the population of the hawks is bigger than 5 cells. This is a game of strong strategic substitutability. The more other people are hawks, the less you want to be a hawk because of the damage that hawks do to each other in this case. And the best response is this downward step function, this heavy side function. Beta is equal to minus 70. There's a unique interior polymorphic equilibrium at 5 cells. So you would expect with these payoffs that 5/7 of the population is going to be hawks and 2/7 are going to be doves, or equivalently, that each individual 5/7 of the time wakes up being a hawk and 2/7 of the time wakes up being a dove. And that's the stable equilibrium outcome. So let me stop there, and now we've gone through quite a bit of this material and see if there are clarifying questions or challenges or... Daniel, Mike, over here.
Has there been any work done in putting this model into dynamic form?
Yes. In fact, the usual way that... Daniel asked if there's been any work done putting this into dynamic form. In fact, a lot. These types of models are most often analyzed using what's called replicator dynamics. So you imagine that you start off and there's a period where a certain fraction are hawks and a certain fraction are doves, and then you see what the payoff to being a hawk and a dove is, and the behavior that has the higher payoff tends to replicate more, and then you get the same type of equilibrium. So what's interesting about this, one interesting thing about this is that you can get exactly these same results, at least for this one-dimensional interaction case, without any explicit, without the explicit dynamics. Just, you just look at that, at the social interaction graph, and we see where the interior equilibrium is and whether it's stable. Okay, there's plenty more here, so we can keep going, and maybe this will prompt some more questions. Strong strategic complementarity, that is where beta is positive, or the beta in the basic model is bigger than 1, is a simple explanation of social conventions. Now, it's obviously going to be a simple explanation because we are dealing with a pretty stripped down model. Everybody is assumed to be exactly the same. There's really only two possible ways to behave. Either you do the social convention behavior or you do other behavior. The action of the typical agent is the frequency with which you act in accord with some social convention, such as working in a particular scientific paradigm. Let's say, how often do you publish a paper as a neoclassical economist? How often do you publish a paper as a heterodox economist? Or conforming to some social expectations based on, say, racial differences. So you live in a segregated society, and that imposes certain asymmetric obligations. Jim Crow said the Jim Crow legislation that we had in the United States imposed asymmetric obligations on whites and blacks in the society. Black people were supposed to go to the back of the bus. If they didn't go to the back of the bus, white people were supposed to criticize them or throw them off the bus or in other ways enforce the, or call the police, or otherwise enforce the enforce the norm. Or let's say a more benign, perhaps, example is you're establishing an account with Facebook. You do or you don't, right? Or buying a Windows computer. The strategic complementarity in these situations arises because the larger the proportion of the members of society who adopt the convention and behave in accordance with it, the stronger are the incentives for the typical member of the society to behave that way and to adopt the convention. The best response of the typical member of the society in this case is an upward step function, so a heavy side function that goes the other way, going from zero up to one as the proportion of other people in the society doing the convention. And that means that there's a kind of a tipping point. There's a book by this guy, Malcolm Gladwell, called The Tipping Point, which is based on this general type of model. In this case, the interior polymorphic equilibrium, the one where some people do the convention and some people don't, is unstable. So it means that you'll always see, if this is an accurate model of what's going on, and there really is strategic complementarity, you're going to see either everybody adopts the convention or nobody adopts the convention, or that's going to be the tendency. But it also raises the point, which Bowles discusses in his microeconomics book, that the stability of these conventions, when you look at them in this way, depends on the assumption that we're only thinking about one individual deviating from the convention. So we're just asking, what is the best response of a single lone individual making a decision herself? That does not mean that these conventions are necessarily stable against multiple deviations. So if a lot of people decide that they say collectively, they coordinate their actions, decide that they are going to resist the convention or try to overthrow it, then you have a totally different situation because you're not in the Nash equilibrium situation where you're taking for granted that everybody else is going to do the convention with a certain probability. And this is a very important part of the story of how social change comes about. Because social change in these examples is very difficult for any individual to manage. Because any individual who tries to go up against a social convention is kind of sunk. You know, everybody's against that person. If you read the novels of Thomas Hardy, for example, this is a theme that Hardy found extremely important about sexual behavior, for example, in rural England of the 19th, 1890s and 1900s, where there were very, very strong social conventions, and he often would pick as the protagonist of his novels, like Tessa of D'Urbervilles and other novels, he would pick an individual for one reason or another deviated from the social convention. And the novel is about what happened, which is not good. No Hardy novel does it ever come out very good. So they're beautiful novels, they're great, very well written, and there's a certain tremendous satisfaction in reading them, but it's not because they have a happy ending, that's for sure. Okay. So let's look at an example, maybe a little less explosive than Tessa the D'Urbervilles or Jim Crow legislation of computer operating systems. So let's suppose now that P bar is the proportion of computer users in our Windows operating system, and the alternative, Linux or Apple, requires somewhat different knowledge of interfaces and occasionally incompatible file transfer methods and standards. Which means that if you're working in a certain working environment or you're interacting with Windows users, it's a hassle to have an Apple computer, but vice versa. If you're working with Apple users, it's a hassle to have a Windows computer. You might model this with the following kind of payoff function. If everybody else is using Windows, then your payoff to using Windows is 10, let's say. But if everybody else is using Windows, the typical agent who uses Linux only gets 5 because they spend more time not being able to transfer their files easily, not being able to coordinate their work very well, and this is symmetrical the other way. Then we can set up again the payoff functions, assuming the P bar is the number of Windows users. Then the payoff to using Windows is 10 times P bar, because that's the 10 that's right up there, plus 5 times 1 minus P bar, that's the payoff when you interact with the Linux user, or 5 plus 5 P bar. If the, and the payoff to being a Linux user is 5 P bar plus 10 times 1 minus P bar, or 10 minus 5 P bar. So this is exactly parallel to the hawk-dove game. But the difference in methodology, right, that is we work out the expected payoffs, just the same way that we did in the hawk-dove game. But in this case, the payoff matrix shows strategic complementarity between the two systems. The more people who are Windows users, the better off you are being, or the higher payoff you get by being a Windows user, as opposed to the hawk-dove thing, where the more hawks were around, the less you wanted to be a hawk because of the damage that hawks do to each other. And we can work out by equating these payoffs what the best response of a risk-neutral agent is going to be. And here's what it's going to be. Your frequency with which you choose Windows is going to be 0 if less than half of the rest of the agents choose Windows, are using Windows. And the frequency with which you use Windows is going to be 1. You're certainly going to choose Windows if the proportion of the others who are using Windows is bigger than a half. That's just the way these symmetrical payoffs work. So this is an example of strong strategic complementarity. The best response function is an upward step function at one half, right? And in this case, the polymorphic equilibrium in the middle, one half, one half, right? 50% of people use Windows and 50% use Linux. Although it's an equilibrium, it's an unstable equilibrium. Even one person switches one direction or the other, and boom, everybody goes to the extreme case. This is a good example of network externality, and it's a good example of the path dependence idea. we know that the if this is actually the strict model and everybody's expected utility maximizers, then we know it, that this society is either going to be all Windows users or all Linux users, right? But we don't know which, because that's going to depend on the accident of who disturbed the symmetry first. Did the first little bit of users somehow wind up with Linux, or did the first little bit of users somehow wind up with Windows? Okay, let me pause here and see if there's some questions. So we've now seen the social interaction model as a model of social convention, where there's strategic complementarity. Alex.
Yes, this is kind of maybe.
Yeah, wait, she's going to get the mic. As soon as we put the mic back together.
Maybe a little unrelated question, but I'm wondering if this would apply to an analysis where it's not an action, but it's a belief. So the concept of conventional wisdom, for example, you're not doing something, but you're choosing to believe something. And if that would fit into this analysis.
Alex asks, I'm repeating the question just in case the other channel doesn't work too well. Alex asks, what about beliefs? Could this be a model of beliefs? Yes, in a society where there's a penalty for believing something different from everybody else, then you have strategic complementarity in beliefs. And I think it's actually a very insightful, it's a very insightful model, because human beings seem to be kind of like that. Now, what typically happens is that not everybody, say, in the whole nation believes in one thing or another, but local pockets of very uniform belief tend to cluster because of this effect. But that also raises a very interesting research question, is what happens around the edges? Natanya, we're going to need the microphone here too. What happens around the edges? Exactly what's going on the edges, and how stable are those edges, and what maintains them against the instability of the polymorphic equilibrium? Kyle.
So I'm just wondering how we would, I guess, amend this to deal with distinct groups actually acting, you know, I guess in conflict with one another. I mean, you have situations where you can choose an individual from a particular group that's to respond to the actions of everyone. But is there a way to incorporate, I mean, of course we talked about relaxing the identity assumption, like, I mean, is there, or what does it look like to have two distinct groups of individuals rather than one massive identical individual, and how does it affect the model?
Okay, so Kyle asks, what happens if you have two interacting heterogeneous groups that are somehow differentiated? They're differentiated not just by their behavior, but they're differentiated before the behavior starts. Well, there are two ways to approach that. You can approach that as a Nash equilibrium problem. If you keep the number of groups and the amount of behavior to a limited range, you can get workable models that way, which have this general flavor, but they're a little different because of the two heterogeneous groups. But curiously enough, in some cases, like the Jim Crow case, it's possible actually to fold the two groups into one action, which is to conform to a certain expectation of behavior. But that expectation of behavior may be different for the two heterogeneous groups. So in that case, you get the, you can actually get some distance even with this very, very simple one-dimensional model. say this analysis of deviation, or how, for example, you can ask questions in evolutionary game theory, how many people have to deviate from one of these norms in order to destroy the stability, which is a very interesting political question. Right.
Just very quickly, why wouldn't we potentially adopt an agent-based approach in that case? Because you'd be abandoning analytical solutions and so forth, but you could make the individual reaction functions somehow, you know, responding to the global state, and you could have like complementarities in this way, but you could also have heterogeneity and look at it that way, but it would be only numerically, I guess, so.
Brian asked the question, could you use an agent, could you set up a similar kind of study in an agent-based, in an agent-based model kind of setting? And yes, you could, and if you had to, that's what you would need to do to get some insight into it. But you would not want to do that, except as a last resort, for several reasons. And when you did it, okay, the reasons are that if you start trying to examine this thing with an agent-based model, you're going to have to make a whole bunch of parametric decisions. So the reason you're going to go to the agent-based model is that you have a lot of heterogeneity. You believe you have a lot of heterogeneity in the agents. Because if you didn't have heterogeneity in the agents, you might as well stick with this, right? Since this is really simple. But if you have a lot of heterogeneity in the agents, then you're going to have to specify the proportions of the different underlying types of agents in your model. And then the referee is going to say, well, suppose you chose a different proportion. Then what would happen to your simulation? And why should I believe your proportion, particularly? Which is either going to lead you to burn out your computer by running simulations for sort of all the possible cases, in which case you may have a paper, you may not have a paper, depending on what happens. And if you did that and you came to me as your thesis advisor, I would say that's great, Brian. Set this up first with homogeneous agents so we can solve it this way, and let's make sure your simulation gives the same result that we're seeing here. That would be the initial, in my view, the initial check that your program is running right. Then do some perturbation of the types of the agents or something like that with the same program, and let's see whether the what happens to the simulated outcomes. Oriel.
So, like, now that we're like discussing heterogeneity, like, and also like replicator dynamics and evolutionary game theory, like, something that I have observed, a way to model heterogeneity is also by imposing space, like a spatial dimension. Like, if you, for example, yeah, instead of having, I mean, you can also use like homogeneous agents, but if they are like distributed in space, sometimes they're also like sub-organization emergence. And yeah, I was more interested, of course, I'm always obsessed in the network aspect of it, instead of like a grid, and I don't know, maybe it's promising to understand things.
Okay, Oriel raises the question of heterogeneity, particularly spatial, that can be represented as spatial heterogeneity. So the agents can be thought of as located in a space and connected, say, by some kind of graph structure or a network structure that tells you their interactions. I think those kind of models are extremely interesting. They use the same logic as this. But again, the main argument is don't do it unless you absolutely have to. and see how far you can get before you have to explode the space up into a graph space. And the main reason for that is that, as you know, the number of graphs, if you have n agents, the number of graphs that can describe interactions among n agents is a huge combinatoric number if n gets to be any substantial size. And you're going to run into the same problem with the referees as Brian does. In fact, Brian is going to be your referee. And he's going to say, why didn't you do this as an agent-based model? And you're going to review his paper, and you're going to say, why didn't you do this on a graph network? And that's, this may sound weird, but actually I've seen exactly this kind of thing happen. Because sometimes behind the scenes, you actually know who the referees are. So I'm not against it. It's beautiful. Some of those models are very beautiful. I mean, you know, the graphics of the graph presentations can be amazing. But again, I would start from something like this and then gradually go step by step to the more elaborated form of the interaction stuff. And I would always go back and check that the degenerate cases, which can be represented in this way, are coming out when you make the degenerate assumption, say that the agents are all at the same point of the graph, or that you have the complete graph, that they're operating with what's called the complete graph that has all the connections. Okay, I think it will be now, we'll take a little break of this lecture. This is the problem of Occam's razor and the question of how simple models should be. Einstein said models should be as simple as possible, but not too simple, which was, as usual with Einstein, right on the mark, but it doesn't necessarily give you a whole lot of guidance when you're trying to write your thesis here this is actually the next slide, which is explanatory power in the social interaction model. And this came up also. I view the social interaction model as at the level of, say, supply and demand as a conceptual model. And I think economics would be much better off if people, instead of their first pass at modeling something through supply and demand, which is what economists typically do, right? The first thing you do is you draw supply and demand with something on the axes. I personally believe economics would get a lot farther if the first impulse was to draw the social interaction graph for this, which is not any more complicated than the supply and demand model. But you know that the social interaction graph, because the intersection has this key property that it's a best response to itself, the equilibrium that you see there are best responses to themselves, that really has a lot more explanatory oomph than just that it's an intersection of parametric supply and demand curves. And therefore, an external agent like an auctioneer who is floating around somehow with a huge amount of free information about the system could get the market to clear at the intersection of the supply and demand curves. But let's talk about this in relation to the social interaction model itself. With a weak social interaction, there's a unique equilibrium. So that sounds pretty good, right? That sounds kind of determined. Although actually, I don't think it's as good as the strong complementarity case, which I'll explain. The unique equilibrium changes with the intensity of the social interaction, the beta coefficient, and the individual acceptance, the alphas. Theory itself could predict that a polymorphic equilibrium will emerge, which is different from the social coordination outcome. So you get quite a bit of mileage out of the social interaction model in terms of explanatory power and understanding in those cases. the equilibrium outcome is essentially independent of initial conditions, and this is very important. So there's no path dependency with the social substitutability. It doesn't really matter where you start. You're always going to converge to the interior polymorphic equilibrium. And so what you see in reality is only going to depend on the individual incentives and the strength of the social interaction. Well, that's pretty good because it's parsimonious. You only have two classes of parameters to make your model. But the theory has little to say about the actual configuration of the outcome, except to point the researcher to finding out just what evidence there is on the levels of individual incentives and the intensity of the social interaction. I don't know if you understand what I'm trying to say there, but it's quite important, I think. So the advantages of it are that you know it's going to be polymorphic equilibrium, you know what the polymorphic equilibrium is going to depend on, and you know that the polymorphic equilibrium is independent of initial conditions. All those, it's ergodic, if you like to think, you know, use that kind of terminology. But the theory itself doesn't tell you where it's going to be. It doesn't tell you whether you're likely to see mostly hawks or mostly doves. The only way you can do that is somehow to figure out what the payoffs are, what the alpha and the beta are that are implied by the payoffs. With strong social interaction, the theory makes the strong qualitative prediction that you're going to go to one or the other extreme, and therefore you're going to have a monomorphic equilibrium. And in many cases, that's the most important thing. We'll see that, for example, in the case of the theory of money. What's important about the theory of money is that you're going to have something functioning as money. That's much more important than to figure out what particular thing is going to be functioning as money in a particular circumstance. And the theory in and of itself tells you that very important idea. And that's going to be regardless of the details of the size of the individual incentives and the intensity of the social interaction. You can vary data around. As long as it stays above one, you're still going to pop to one or the other extreme case, right? I'll explain a very interesting point about that in just a moment, which is what happens when beta is really close to one or equal to one, so that you have the, you're just on the edge of the strong strategic complementarity. The theory, however, is uninformative as to which extreme outcome is going to prevail because of the path dependency problem. And in many cases, though, this is what you want, because in many cases you have the strong feeling that an equilibrium is very stable and it's a social convention that's very well entrenched, but it could have turned out quite differently. You have New Hampshire and Vermont, for example, where everything is sort of like through the looking glass. New Hampshire has no income tax, no sales tax, and as a result, it has all the commercial development along the Connecticut River that divides the two states. Vermont has big, heavy sales tax and taxes individual school districts if they spend too much money on their kids to redistribute it to the other school districts. Two totally different ideas. Think about this in terms of the individual and society, which is one of the big themes of social science in general and economics in particular. It represents the interaction of the individual and society, in my view, in what I would call dialectical terms. If I think about this in Hegelian or even Marxian terms. What characterizes the individual from this point of view is not her difference from other individuals. Think about that. And this has to do with the whole question of heterogeneity. See, what this is starting from is not the fact that the individual is an individual because she's different from other individuals. What makes the individual an individual, because all the individuals are identical in all relevant aspects, so that really there's no difference among them. what characterizes the individual in the social interaction model is the separation of her individual sphere of action from the social sphere of action. She's an individual because she controls her action, but she doesn't control other people's actions. She has to take other people's actions as given. That's what makes her an individual in the social interaction context. There's a good deal of irony in the social interaction model, which is easy to see. Which has to do with this favorite theme of 18th century philosophy of unintended consequences, the importance of unintended consequences. On the one hand, the behavioral outcome of the individual is being determined by her interaction with society. This is especially clear in the strategic complementarity case, where the deviant faces enormously strong pressures and enormously strong incentives not to deviate as an individual from the social convention. But despite the fact that all the individuals are the same and they're all in fundamentally exactly the same position and have exactly the same interests, the social interaction itself condemns them to equilibrium outcomes none of them would necessarily have chosen. That is, the socially uncoordinated outcomes. We're going to see this, for example, in Marx's theory of the falling of the top. All the capitalists want to raise the rate of profit and they wind up lowering the rate of profit, and in a number of other examples. Nonetheless, the equilibrium outcome is the reflection of the typical individual's behavior. So it's not, the results are social, not natural constraints. If you read Hardy's novels, it looks like social convention is just like the law of gravity, right? Trying to go against social convention is just the same as trying to float up into the clouds. You're just not going to be able to do it. But in fact, in the social interaction model, these constraints are social constraints. They are the behavior of other people. In fact, in this extreme case, the behavior of other people exactly like yourself, who are in exactly the same pickle. This leads to this point that while individual deviation is very difficult in the social interaction model, it also offers a path to a political theory of change, which is when more than one individual tries to deviate or change the system at one time. Look at this whole question of causation and explanation and how very complex, how many things are thrown into doubt when you just start thinking about the social interaction equilibrium. Let me take a parable that I made up of the village of clean shaven men. Okay. So we have this village, and most of the men in the village show up every day clean shaven. Each man has a preference to look the same as all the others. This is not a completely strange or irrelevant idea. The direct, but what's the causation here? I would say, well, what's the direct cause of my being clean shaven? It's that I shaved myself this morning. That's simple enough. If I didn't shave myself, I wouldn't be clean shaven, right? On the other hand, why did I shave myself this morning? The reason I shaved myself this morning was because I predicted that you would shave this morning. And my prediction turned out to be correct. So which is the causation? Where is the, there's no linear causation. We can see perfectly transparently what's going on in the strategic complementarity case. And you can see why you have the monomorphic equilibrium. That's not hard to understand from the incentives that the individuals see. But causality is very difficult to understand. Exactly what causes the monomorphic. I believe that, for example, Hegel was very interested in this kind of question, and in fact viewed it as the paradigmatic question in social science. So if you ever have the somewhat masochistic desire to read Hegel's Science of Logic or something like that, you might, I think it makes it much clearer if you think of this, if you keep this example in mind. Much of what he has to say, which seems to be completely weird and strange in language, actually makes quite a lot of sense if you situate it in this type of interaction. Okay, now let me finish up with a few slides on some points that we've already brought up. Dynamics. And this goes to Brian's question, Oriel's question about the agent-based models and a number of other things. There's a hand-waving element in what I told you, which is that I point to that interior equilibrium. I say it's stable or unstable depending on whether the best response cuts the 45-degree line above or below. And you more or less bought that, or at least nobody threw a rotten tomato at me for that. If Professor Velipalar was still around, he might actually throw a rotten tomato, because he believes very strongly in the necessity of making dynamic arguments explicit. But is it really a good idea, say, if you're trying to do research on a practical problem, to make it explicit? There's no question that Professor Velipalar is correct, that in order to study the stability of a dynamical system rigorously, we have to specify its non-equilibrium dynamics and use the tools of dynamical system analysis to determine stability. That's correct. And it would be possible to specify a variety of dynamic models for any of these scenarios that we've talked about in the social interaction model. One particular very often used one is replicator dynamics in evolution and game theory setting. But you always find when you do that, that you have a bunch of spare parameters floating around, which have to do with things like speeds of adjustment. And those come up also in the agent-based, modeling. How rapidly does the information diffuse through, say, the graph or the network, and how fast do the agents pick up on that, and so forth. And unfortunately, when you change those parameters, often the qualitative behavior of the simulations actually changes. And there's where you get into trouble with the referees, because then the referees say, well, why should we believe this regime instead of that regime? Which the referees are increasingly doing with papers of this type. So I would argue that dynamic detail is hugely informative when information is available to pin down the exact parameters determining time constants and dynamic processes. But this type of information is often very hard to come by in economic contexts. Whereas something like the shape of the best response of a typical individual is not so hard to come by. Whether the interaction has strategic complementarity or strategic substitutability may be pretty obvious when you talk to people, just qualitatively talking to people, or just observing what happens. So I would, this, now I'm skating on very thin ice, but if I were giving you advice, I would say you might be better off when you're working with crummy economic data and rather ill-posed economic questions, you might be better off avoiding the dynamics by adopting something like this equilibrium set. God will send the thunderbolt down. Okay. Now, let me just talk about a couple of other points here. If we go back to this interactive figure, which is way away now, we saw that it's possible this kind of thing can happen, that you've got, let's say, a stable equilibrium, good equilibrium, socially coordinated equilibrium up here. That's what you one, maybe. And but as alpha moves, so I'm gonna move up in this way. Suppose alpha starts moving this way. Well, what's happening now is that because the private incentive to the action is getting small, or maybe even negative, it's harder and harder to sustain this good equilibrium. And the way that the model is telling you that is because you're seeing the unstable equilibrium creep up on the stable good equilibrium. And in fact, if it catches up with it, boom, the stable equilibrium up there disappears. Now, it still turns out that that point where the limit intersects the 45 degree line is the socially coordinated equilibrium. That's still where you would like to be. But there's no way you're ever going to be able to sustain that, because it's not a best response to itself. So you're going to have to land down here. Now, this has a couple of things to think about. Suppose this is a picture of, let's say, financial crisis or something. So here we are with high asset values sustained by some kind of social complementarity in asset markets. And the Fed starts raising the interest rate because they think it's speculative. And boom, okay. Now first, this touches on this question of a dynamic. What do you think the dynamics are in that cusp capacity? If you believe in it. Now you have to believe in this. You can't keep on not engaging. You're gonna have to accept that this is really a way of looking at the way the world really is and stuff that really happens. It's an abstract picture, but it's what's really happening. Well, you're never going to find out, okay, what happens at that moment when the equilibrium stops existing. I mean, the what's happening is that the market or the interaction is losing any kind of signals as to where it ought to go, right? So it's going to go in all directions. In fact, when we get really close here, the market is already going to lose any kind of direction or stability, and you're going to find high volatility where the X goes back and forth because it doesn't have any guide as to what's going on. Okay, then if you actually have the cusp catastrophe, then what happens? Well, who knows what all of these agents do? I mean, then the whole organization of this thing falls apart. For one thing, it's unlikely that all the other agents are going to do the same thing out of equilibrium. They're all going to do something different. Some people are going to sell out their margin accounts. Some people are going to buy stocks. Some people are going to do all kinds of different things. So this whole framework falls apart. If you were really going to try to do the disequilibrium dynamics, you move from a very simple model to a very complex model. And not only that, you're never going to find any data. You're going to have to be one of these nano traders and look at the order books, you know, nanosecond by nanosecond, and even then you're not going to be able to reconstruct what actually happened in this thing. So this is another example of why I would be cautious about the going for full dynamics. Now, there's another point here. I didn't get that lecture 5. See, we're just so much. Now, what happens, look at what happens when beta gets close to 1. So we've got beta close to 1. It's not exactly the 1, it's 1.04. So there actually is an equilibrium there. But look at what's happening. The system in this case, because the social interaction exactly coincides with the equilibrium condition, it means that pretty much all of these points are either equilibrium or they're very close to equilibrium. Now, you can say to yourself, well, that's not good because we don't have determinacy of equilibrium. You can think of it in that way. But the way a physicist would think about this, the physicist would call this a phase transition. And the physicist would say, okay, when beta gets close to 1, the system doesn't know where to go. It has no structure to tell it where to go. And as a result, what physicists expect to see at beta close to 1 is what are called scale-free fluctuations. This is what you see, for example, in thermodynamic systems at melting points or at boiling points and things like that. Which means that fluctuations of every scale, well, it can't go beyond the limits here, but every scale is relevant to the problem, are going to be viable when beta is exactly equal to 1. They're going to be close to viable when beta is almost equal to 1. This then predicts that if you're in an asset market or something like that, when you're close to this bifurcation point, one signal you're going to see is huge increase in volatility. Because, and we understand from this way of looking at it, what the problem is there. Same thing would be true, let's say, in social revolutions. When beta is equal to 1, nobody's quite sure whether they want to be a white Russian or a red Russian, right? Looks like it's pretty equal. And as a result, you have chaos. You don't have any social organization. You just have complete chaos. Let me see if I can get through a last slide here. Ability of clean chain man, the cusp catastrophe phase transition. Okay, one last remark, which has to do also with this question of simple models and complex models. You can certainly make these models more complicated by making the agents more heterogeneous. You keep track of a lot of heterogeneous agents. I personally don't think you're going to learn a great deal in many economic cases by doing that. Because I think, and the classical political economists tend to go along with this, that for most practical purposes, everybody's exactly alike. You know, even though some of them are ordering strawberry ice cream, and some of them are ordering chocolate ice cream, and some are ordering vanilla ice cream, that's really not a very important issue in social life. The more important issues are the ones in which we're all kind of in the same boat, and we're all alike. We're all trying to decide whether to drive our cars to work on the congested interstate or not. That's, in my view anyway, more relevant. But another dimension that you might think of generalizing this model is the dimensionality of the action. I think, actually, Kyle, you're starting to think about a little bit. So maybe we don't have just one dimension of action. We have, let's say, two dimensions of action. And the payoff function for the typical individual depends on what everybody else is doing in both of those dimensions. And she has to decide how to maximize payoff in both of those dimensions. Now, the best response function. There's nothing, I mean, methodologically, this is fine. You still have the same methodology, which is you want to find the best response function. The best response function, though, now is a two-dimensional function defined on a two-dimensional domain. In fact, the most natural way to express it would be as complex variable. That's a function of a complex variable. It's complex variables already on a two-dimensional domain. And you know that now the stability question, which in the one dimension is just the question of whether the best response function cuts the 45-degree line from above or below, in two dimensions it becomes much more complicated. And you know that you may have other kinds of stable outcomes. You may have limits of it. where you may even have some kind of chaotic motions in two dimensions with these left mappings in two dimensions. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. That's all very fascinating mathematically and could be extremely illuminating for practical problems if you have to. But be aware, when you move from one to two dimensions, that's not a trivial step analytically. That's going to involve you in quite a bit more mathematical complexity. And in fact, what I would suggest is that beginning with that, you are going to have to make some other very strong simplifying assumptions in two dimensions in order to tame down these possibilities. And then we can get into three dimensions. But that probably is a subject for another day.